It's August 1961, and in a Las Vegas casino, a middle-aged man looks across at his partner in crime. Between them, they've devised a system for beating the house, and a device to help them do it. A device that will change the way the world communicates. This isn't about money. It's about beating the establishment, a stand against those greedy capitalist casinos. Their new device was developed in a lab, because they're academics, self-confessed geeks, but the safety of those familiar surroundings now feels a long way away. In the heart of mob-run Vegas, they're risking everything, including their lives, on one final spin of the wheel. In front of his friend, there's a growing pile of chips, growing at an impossible rate. They always knew there was one big mistake they could make, not knowing when to quit. If they get busted, their reputation will be in tatters, but because they're in Vegas, that would be the least of their worries. It's January 1st, 1960, the dawn of a new decade, and America is buzzing. After 15 years of sleepy post-war evolution, it's time for a revolution. Technology is bringing the future. Every household has a taste of it. Televisions and portable radios, washing machines and microwave ovens. To the average Joe, the world is suddenly moving forward at an incredible pace. But for one man in Cambridge, Massachusetts, things are moving far too slowly. The man is a 44-year-old scientist. He's already proven himself to be decades ahead of his time, publishing his findings in the mid-1930s, the Magna Carta of the information age, that he knows one day will make the impossible possible, paving the way for telecommunications, the internet, and artificial intelligence. But today, he's ready for a different kind of breakthrough, one that will push him out of his comfort zone and eventually face to face with real world danger. He's restless, bored, a crackpot professor who, already a legend, has earned his right to sit and daydream. So he asks himself a question: how can I use technology to achieve the impossible today? And the answer starts with computers. As far as the average household is concerned, they barely exist, belonging in big academic institutions only, as room-sized mega computers which take hours to complete the smallest of tasks, like the cutting-edge yet painfully slow IBM 704 housed where he sits bored at MIT, the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, supposedly the most progressive academic institution in the world. But what use exactly is a computer confined to a lab? His mission is to take computers into the outside world. The question is, how? The professor's name is Claude Elwood Shannon, and his happy place is at home, a three-story wooden house he shares with his wife, Betty, because down in the basement, it's a gadgeteer's paradise with $100,000 worth of mechanical and electrical components, motors, transistors, switches, pulleys, gears, condensers, transformers, and so on. At his heart, he's an inventor, like Leonardo da Vinci, or Nikola Tesla, Doc Brown, and Willy Wonka, an eccentric mad professor who loves to build the future so he can use it himself, right now. Here, when he's not juggling, unicycling, or tightrope walking, he's making gadgets, some just for fun, such as flame-throwing trumpets, rocket-powered frisbees, and a machine which does only one thing when you switch it on, switches itself off again, but others so he can achieve the impossible, a coin flipper that always lands on whatever you tell it to, heads or tails. Styrofoam shoes that allow him to walk on water, and a robotic mouse which can learn to solve a maze. To Claude, nothing is impossible, except coming out with his own new idea that could change the world now with computers, until he meets Edward O. Thorp. Edward Thorp is a mathematician, and just like Claude, he's based at MIT. He loves mixing things up. He's fresh from revolutionising blackjack with a card counting system that enabled him to beat Vegas. And in September 1960, he tells Claude about another idea. In the spring of 1955, while finishing my second year of graduate physics at UCLA, I thought about whether it was possible to beat the roulette wheel. In fact, he'd been thinking about it since he was a kid, but there and then, they agreed to work on the idea together. To use science, math, and computers, whatever the two inventors need to call upon to beat roulette. It's a crazy plan, and their wives are not happy. Of all the most widely played games played in casinos across America up until this time, roulette had consistently offered the worst odds. It first appeared as we know it in 1796, where it became the favoured high-stakes game of the rich and royal, people who only got excited by winning big, because they could always afford to lose. Because when it comes to a rigged game, like roulette, you will lose. Today, a European roulette wheel has 37 pockets, whilst an American one has 38, numbered 1 through 36, plus a 0 and a double 0. If the game was fair, picking the right single number would get you a payout of 38 to 1, but it doesn't. You get paid 35 to 1. This difference gives the casinos an edge of 5.26%. You might think if you bet on red or black and win, the payout is even, so you double your stake. But again, because of those two extra greens, you're actually being under-rewarded. But the main problem is luck, because unlike most card games, where there's at least some skill involved, and a good player can give themselves an edge over rivals or minimise the edge held by the house, roulette is, in theory, completely random. And that's where Claude and Edward start. They say that actually, it's not random. They think fate doesn't dictate where the ball ends up, physics does. And that's part one of their plan, using physics to wipe away the casino's unfair advantage. Edward recalls how a favourite high school teacher described a trip to Vegas where the orbiting ball of a roulette wheel reminded him of a planetary system and of a pendulum that's gradually dissipating energy. Inspired, they head to Reno and buy a roulette wheel. It sets them back $1,500. Already, they're pushing themselves to the limit. With modest academic salaries and mouths to feed, they'll need to work after hours to get the job done. And they do so, down in Claude's basement lab, working into the night, 20 hours a week, running test after test and recording their work. Until eventually, they have a system. It works like this. In roulette, the wheel, with its numbered pockets, is spun in one direction, usually clockwise, while the ball is launched in the other along the outer edge of the wheel's rim. Initially, centripetal force maintains the ball's circular path, but as it's slowed by friction and gravity, it loses momentum, and eventually, falls off the track into the middle section before settling into a numbered pocket on the spinning rotor at the bottom. Breaking it down, first they must predict when and where the orbiting ball will leave the outer track. They do this by measuring the time it takes to complete one revolution by hitting the switch to record its start and end. Next, they must predict the time the ball would take and the distance it would travel across the middle section. And further recordings make this possible too. Once the ball gets to the pockets, its movements are more random, but the results are still recorded. With a system for recording this key info in place, part two of their plan is to create a device which can enable them to exploit it, namely a computer, something which can receive their data, process it using algorithms they've devised, and calculate a useful output. In April and May of 1961, their work intensifies. The project must be finished before September, when Edward moves to a new job in LA. They also do some field work in Vegas, noticing that some wheels are tilted. Back in the lab, they discover that this contributing gravity creates less randomness than a flat wheel, and decide that a half chip tilt, equal to putting a coin half the thickness of a casino chip under one of the 3 feet of the wheels, is ideal. And then, at the end of June 1961, they have their computer. A computer small enough to take anywhere. A computer which passes their benchmark for success. If the computer predicts a number, the ball just needs to fall within a range of 16 neighbouring numbers around it, in order for them to have an edge. In fact, they're consistently accurate within a range of 10 neighbouring numbers. They've come up with a system to predict physics and a gadget, which no one has seen, to process that information and help them beat the house. But will it work in the chaos of the real casino? They're ready to find out. It's 1961 now, and Claude and Ed have dedicated a year of their lives to project roulette. If it fails, they'll not only lose all the time and the thousands of dollars that they've invested, but they'll also face academic humiliation, and if they cross the wrong people, serious trouble. As they settle into a journey in hotel rooms though, with their wives Betty and Vivian, there's a holiday mood. The four head out to find the casino they'll visit the next day, settling on the one with the right tilt of the wheel and the nicest ambience. And then they go for dinner, where Claude asks Ed, "What makes you tick?" It's a semi-serious question. The two have driven themselves towards a crossroads. Once they step over the threshold and really do this, it changes everything. But it's also a joke, a reference to how the world's first wearable computer actually works. The next day, the four head into the casino, where they pretend to be strangers. Claude, Betty, and Vivian are nervous, and they're right to be. The mafia-riddled gaming industry is not something to mess with. Edward, though, is calm. He's beaten casinos already, and he thinks, what's the worst that can happen? Maybe he's about to find out. Their system requires a two-man team. Claude is the observer. He wears the transmitting computer, made of two units, each the size of a packet of cigarettes, each fitting uncomfortably inside his shoes. There, the data logging the movement of the wheel and the ball is entered with mercury switches operated by his big toes. Click. Transmitted by radio waves using equipment modified from a model airplane to a receiver worn around the waist of the bettor, Ed. ultra-thin stainless steel wires painted a flesh colour, then run up his body and are delicately soldered to an earphone, which plays a variety of coded musical tones, telling him what to do. To distract the dealer and casino security meanwhile, Claude holds a little notepad and writes down the winning number after each roll, just like another doomed-to-fail system player. They settle at a table, sitting far apart. Betty and Vivian keep watch, making sure no one's getting suspicious. The croupier gives the wheel a push. Claude presses a big toe down. Click. And they're underway. Each time, the computer tells Edward which one of the eight groups of five adjacent numbers to bet on. It's a common roulette strategy, with the French calling such a group a visionnage or neighbourhood. The zero and double zero appear twice, because there are 38 numbers on the board, but the 5 times 8 groups total 40. A normal player who bets on all 5 numbers in one of those 8 neighbourhoods is a 1 in 8 chance of winning, with the house maintaining a 5.26% advantage. Using the computer though, Claude and Edward win 1 in 5 times because they're sure the ball will land in one of the 5 octants, not the other 3, giving them an extraordinary 44% edge. Based on the signals he's receiving from Claude, Ed starts betting cautiously, betting just 10 cent chips. Within a few spins, the computer works its magic, turning a few dimes into a heap as yet another bet scores. But it's late summer in Vegas. The electrical thrum of the casino adds to the temperature, as do the nerves, and before long, the inevitable happens. Ed gets hot and uncomfortable, and those ultra-thin wires start to break. Their night is over, and so they head back to their rooms to get the solder out and plan again. At least they got away with it, for now. The next day, the foursome are back at it, this time placing bigger bets. And again, it works. The 44% edge that they proved in the lab works in Vegas, and the chips start to pile up. Again though, the wires keep breaking. It's a disaster. Back they go to the room in a hurry, solder out, then back on the tables as quick as they possibly can. To cheat success at gambling, you need to multiply your money fast before the inevitable heat comes on strong. You bet your stake and win. Then you add a percentage of your winnings to create a bigger stake, win, and so on. Every time they return to their rooms though, they lose momentum. The stress is getting to everyone. Claude and Edward are academics. To them, it's essential that they complete their experiment, and that means demonstrating consistent returns. But the trouble they're courting could end their careers, and their wives know it. Panic is setting in, and they want out. Eventually, under pressure from their wives, they agree to return to the roulette wheel just one final time. One final time to go big with one final game, and then they'll get out. It's a plan, and calm is restored. After all, they haven't actually been caught yet. The following morning, they sleep late. When they rise, they eat, and then they pack ready to leave. And then as the night falls on Vegas, and the city comes alive in all of its filth and glory, they begin. It's the moment of truth. The chips start to pile up once more. The bets get bigger, and so do the wins. It's working. Just keep going, just a little longer. It is, though, impossible to ignore. The vultures are circling. Winning attracts attention, most of all from casino security. Betty and Vivian are on edge, convinced that something bad is coming. One wrong move, one malfunction, and everything could come crashing down. And then it happens. A woman sitting next to Ed turns to him. And then suddenly, her eyes widen in horror. His earpiece and wire are clearly poking out. She wants to speak, to say something. But what, and to whom? Edward leaves the table fast. Heart pounding, he heads to the restroom to fix the wire. They should leave, now. They know they're walking a fine line, but they just want one more win. So he heads back to join Claude at the wheel, trying to stay calm. Breathe. Everything is normal, nothing to see. And he carries on. Those fragile wires need to hold up one last time. He locks eyes with Claude. The wheel spins. Click. The calculations are made, transmitted, and received. An octant is bet on, all in one final time. The ball drops and finally settles exactly as predicted. They've done it, and now it's time to get away. Claude Shannon and Ed Thorp leave Vegas, not as millionaires, but as pioneers and friends. We got along, well, because from an early age, science was at play for both of us. Tinkering and building things was part of the fun, as was letting our curiosity range freely. So could two self-confessed geeks build the world's first wearable computer and prove that with science and maths, they could outsmart a rigged game to beat the big guy and win? The answer is yes. Although they keep the system under wraps until Edward mentions it in his book, Blackjack Beat the Dealer. The pair donate the hardware to the MIT Museum. It's all explained in a paper titled The Invention of the First Wearable Computer, published in 1998, laying the groundwork for the wearable tech worn by billions of people around the world today, from Google Glass to Apple Watches. In the years that follow, Claude Shannon returns to his academic work, cementing his legacy as the father of information theory, paving the way for the internet and digital communication. His work on computer learning predates artificial intelligence. Ed Thorp, meanwhile, leaves Vegas and academia behind as he takes on the greatest casino on Earth, Wall Street. Check out the next video and see what happened.